morning.
Good morning.
So I'm going to play a song for you that I wrote. Seemed appropriate service to do it in. Has a modest objective: change the world. There's people dying, people crying all over the land. It's nothing new, no, you've seen it too, and we're doing all we can. Or are we? It's time for all generations to quit speculation and take a hardline stand for freedom and love and life and peace. And why we don't understand these words I'm saying are more than 60 years old. Man, they've been around since the beginning of time. And if we got together to speak in one loud voice, yeah, we could make these words yours and mine. Oh, love and peace will only cease if we allow it to. The government looks after itself. Who'll look after me and you? It's time for change. Stop the hard rain of oppression, racism, and bloodshed. So let's say it so clear. Change the world, my friend. There's people suffering, people struggling all over the land. It's nothing new, no, you've seen it too, and we're doing all we can. Or are we? It's time for all generations to quit speculation and take a hardline stand for freedom, love, life, and peace. And why we don't, I don't understand these words I'm saying are more than 60 years old. Man, they've been around since the beginning of time. And if we got together to speak in one loud voice, yeah, we could make these words yours and mine. Oh, love and peace will only cease if we allow it to. The government looks after itself. Who'll look after me and you? It's time for change. Stop hard rain of oppression, racism, and bloodshed. So let's say it so clear and utterly sincere, and we can change. I know we can change this whole world, my friend.
Hi there. So we're actually doing, at the order of services, ICARE ceremony. This is actually the ICARE commissioning service is what we're doing here this morning. So I need the members of the ICARE Social Justice Ministry who are present here today to come up front for us, please. Just like song leaders coming up. And on this side, too, if you want to. Oh, we have such a good group this year. So many of you here know what ICARE is because we do this every year. Some of you are new. So I thought this time around I would just take a few minutes to explain. And then we'll go ahead and go through with our ceremony. So all faith traditions call on their people to do justice, including Unitarian Universalists. In fact, we're quite proud of that. But What is justice? How do we all agree so that we can work together and have the power to make some real change? ICARE is a justice ministry that cooperates across all faiths. It's not the only thing you can do for justice. It's one thing you can do. But since we do cooperate across all faiths, we're obligated to take a very practical approach to justice. We ask people what they need, and then we do something about it. That's why we do house meetings every fall. We meet in small groups within our congregations, and we ask people who are hurting, what do they need? Here's what they told us. They need safe neighborhoods, free from crime and violence. They need people with health problems to get compassionate treatment, especially people who are suffering from mental illness. And then after seeing the worst flooding in Jacksonville's 250-year history from Tropical Storm Irma in 2017, they need to protect their homes, businesses, and neighborhoods from more storms like this. So that's what we work on. Winning justice can take years, but every year ICARE shows up and moves us closer to the solutions. On April 15th this year, ICARE is preparing to bring over 1,000 people to its Nehemiah Assembly. We'll put ideas in front of our city leaders that have worked in other communities. We'll ask our leaders to take action. So we're here today to commission our churches, BBUUC's ICARE network members to serve in this ministry once again. The task that they have is to answer your questions about ICARE and encourage as many people as possible from this community to attend the Nehemiah Assembly. Okay, now, we were gonna have some stuff in the order of service and I don't see it there, so I'm gonna give you guys some instructions. So, network members who are standing here from ICARE, will you help build our church's capacity to do justice through the example of your commitment to ICARE and by inviting others into this work? If so, say, I will. Congregation, will you recognize the commitment of these network members and support them in our church's ICARE justice ministry? If you would like to do so, please say, I will. I present you with this year's ICARE network members. Working together, we can build fairness in our community and bend the moral arc of the universe towards justice. Who cares?
I care.
When we all work together, thank you so much.
I would like to invite Carl Moody, please, to come forward to light this morning's chalice. The words are by Leonard Mason. We affirm the unfailing renewal of life, rising from the earth and reaching for the sun. All living creatures shall fulfill themselves. We affirm the steady growth of human companionship, rising from ancient cradles and reaching for the stars. People the world over shall seek the ways of understanding. We affirm a continuing hope that out of every tragedy, the spirits of individuals shall rise to build a better world. Unitarian Universalist faith is rooted in the practice of integrity, goodwill, and a relentless desire for understanding. On this foundation, we support ourselves and others in sustaining the universe of beliefs through which we live our faith. With no one right way to uphold our UU principles, we hold our community together with a shared promise. We reaffirm this covenant weekly to center ourselves in that spirit as we enter worship together. I would like to invite you to please remain seated as we share in reading our congregational covenant, which is behind me on the screen above. We covenant to engage one another with honesty, kindness, and respect, to value diversity, seek understanding of our differences, and practice gracious accountability with care, love, and empathy. We make these promises to those who are here and those yet to come so that we may be a safe, welcoming, and beloved community of acceptance, learning, and transformation. And there is a slight change to your order of service today. Dr. Gary Smart will not be our accompanist. We instead have Eileen Morrison. If you would please rise in body or spirit, we will sing our call to worship. The words are written in your order of service. Our opening words this morning are by Rosemary Watola Tromer. I need a rainstorm on the inside, the kind that relentlessly pours, the kind that rearranges everything, leaves nothing untouched. I need a deluge that drowns out any voices that would offer easy answers. I need a cloudburst to flood everything I think I know that carries me until I too am current. Have I gotten so dry inside, so brittle and sure? Give me a gully washer, the kind that scours and remakes its path as it flows. I want it, and yet when I feel the first drops, I scramble for the umbrella as if it would do any good. There it is, petrichor. Earthy fragrance of change. The big rain will come when it comes. There will be no stopping it then. And here we are. Welcome all. My name is Caitlin Regan, and my pronouns are she and her. I've been a member here at BBUUC for 7 years, and if I've learned nothing else in those years, I've come to understand that Unitarian Universalism is not easy, and it's not intended to be so. It drives us past what is comfortable toward what is right. Through our seven principles, we are forced to face many difficult truths, but also to embrace the possibility that glows softly within them. When we come through these doors on Sunday mornings, we accept the challenge of our faith. We poke holes in our assumptions and push past our boundaries. That's a big way to start a Sunday morning. But what really matters, though, is what we do on Monday. That is where progress begins. If this is your first time at BBUUC, or you're returning after being away for a while, I would like to extend you a special welcome. We are so glad you're here. We hope you'll take some time to learn more about us by visiting our welcome table or mingling with our members at the back of the sanctuary after the service. We'll be serving light refreshments, and you can learn more about Unitarian Universalism, our church, and our welcoming committee, Congregation. If you've been coming for a while and are interested in becoming a member, we offer regular Learn About BBUUC classes. And if you're interested in membership, any of our members would be glad to help guide you toward the path to membership. Welcome, and thank you for joining us today. I would also like to take a moment right now to mention that in 2 more weeks, on April 31st, we will have our annual Easter Sunday worship service, which is a multi-generational family service followed by an Easter egg hunt for our young ones and a potluck dinner for all. In planning the dinner, our wonderful hospitality folks have asked us to help ensure that we have a great variety of choices for our meal by signing up physically on the sheets in the entryway, or by going to the perfect potluck link in our This Week newsletter. You can also scan the QR code on the bulletin board in the entryway. So thank you in advance for that. March is Stewardship Month here at BBUUC, and as you consider what contributions you'd like to return to this community, I would like to invite David Prohofsky to come up and talk about what this church means to him. Welcome, David.
Thank you, Caitlin. Good morning. You may wonder, how is it that having been a full member for less than a year, I ended up here? And the answer is, Chuck asked the board if they would be willing to speak. Fair enough. How did I get on the board? Well, seemed we needed help with the finance committee, turned into the treasury role. Somebody asked me, and so I'm here. And then I asked myself, how is it I felt comfortable having been a member such a short time coming up and doing this? And the answer goes back to how when I was 5 years old, the very, very learned and very charismatic rabbi of our community left for one about 30 times larger. And while there were attempts at times for our synagogue to hire a new rabbi, and some stayed for a year, generally they were without a rabbi for the entirety of my childhood and even into my young adult years. And it worked. The community ran the religious services that the community wanted. They educated their children the way the community wanted. They ran themselves the way they wanted. It was a small community running on democratic principles, making the world a better place. And they had impact far beyond their numbers in their part of Indiana. I hope that sounds familiar to you. And so to get back to the asking of questions in Stewardship Month, I hope you're all asking yourselves what this place means to you and what you can do to participate and lead and contribute to the wonderful work we do here. And that's really the only important question for each of us. Thank you.
And now I would like to invite you to please rise in body or spirit. We'll sing hymn number 183, The Wind of Change Forever Blown. This hymn may be unfamiliar to many of us, so Eileen is going to play it through one time, and then we'll sing all of the verses. Thank you. And now Beth Curtis will come forward for our time for all ages.
Good morning. There we go. One beautiful morning, a young boy was out in a butterfly garden that he and his parents had planted. It was a very exciting time because one of the swallowtail caterpillars had created a chrysalis just a few weeks before. He knew that a butterfly would be emerging from it very soon. So he was keeping a close eye on it. And sure enough, that morning, the chrysalis started to move. Almost imperceptibly, he could see the tiny wings inside the chrysalis move this way and then that. Then the whole chrysalis started moving, rocking. Back and forth, and it looked like the butterfly was trying to get out of a straitjacket. Can you imagine being all cramped up in there? Then a small crack appeared, and out sprang what? An antenna? And then it stopped. It just stopped. The boy sat and waited. The movement would start again, and then it would stop again. And not much was happening, and the boy started to worry. The boy's dad came out and saw what was going on. "Can't we help the butterfly, Dad? It's struggling. It can't get out. It must just be so tired of struggling. What if we got a pair of scissors and carefully helped it out of the chrysalis? Oh, I'm just so worried about our butterfly." The dad smiled. "I know you're concerned about the butterfly, and that is an admirable thing. But this is all part of the process. It takes time. Doing the butterfly's work for it would be the worst thing we could do. You see, when a butterfly comes out of its chrysalis, its abdomen is all bloaty and its wings are really quite small and quite wrinkly from being tucked inside that chrysalis while it was transforming. That struggle you've been watching is all part of its change. The butterfly needs to move inside of its chrysalis. That movement, that effort to be free of the chrysalis starts its blood pumping into its wings and its body so that when it emerges, its body will slim out and its wings will spread so that soon it will be able to fly. If we help it, it will never be able to fly. Its wings will never spread and its abdomen will stay too big. The best it could hope for is watching other butterflies fly." The boy nodded, understanding and wanting what was best for this butterfly. He realized he was witnessing a real struggle. But that struggle would allow for something wonderful to happen. Now, the moral of this story is not to not help people when they're struggling. You see, there's different kinds of struggle. If someone is struggling because of loss or because they are sad, absolutely offer your help to those people. Go ahead and help people who are struggling because they just have too much to do. But if someone is experiencing the kind of struggle that happens with learning something new or changing or even going through a metamorphosis of their own, be careful how much you help them, or they might never be able to fly.
It takes a collective effort to keep our church vibrant and strong. I would like to invite Renee Berberick and Marilyn Jones to come forward for this morning's offering. The plates we pass and what we put into them provide the sustenance we need to keep our church moving forward in support of meaningful change. Whatever the size of your contribution, even if only the gift of your positive energy, please take the plate and pass it to your neighbor to keep our energy flowing. Everything we gather this morning supports our values and principles. All we collect strengthens our core and pushes boundaries. We thank you for all you're able to give. Once we've received this morning's offering, please rise in body or spirit as we sing hymn number 123, Spirit of Life.
Reverend Andrew Weber begins this sermon, which he originally presented at the Unitarian Universalist Church of Delaware County, Pennsylvania, with a reading. The British government formerly abolished slavery in its colonies with the passage of the Slavery Abolition Act of 1833. The legislation went into effect in August of 1834, whereby all slaves in the British Empire were considered free under British law. On August 3rd, 1857, Frederick Douglass delivered a West India Emancipation Speech at Canandaigua, New York, on the 23rd anniversary of the law. Frederick Douglass began, quote, "Friends and fellow citizens, We have met here today to celebrate with all fitting demonstrations of joy and gladness this, the 23rd anniversary of the inauguration of freedom as the ruling law in the British West Indies. Let me give you a word on the philosophy of reform. The whole history of the progress of human liberty shows that all concessions yet made to her august claims have been born of earnest struggle. The conflict has been exciting, agitating, all-absorbing, and for the time being, putting all other tumults to silence. It must do this or it does nothing. If there is no struggle, there is no progress. Those who profess to favor freedom and yet deprecate agitation are men who want crops without plowing up the ground. They want rain without thunder and lightning. They want the ocean without the awful roar of its many waters. The struggle may be a moral one, or maybe a physical one, and it may be both moral and physical, but it must be a struggle. Power concedes nothing without a demand. It never has, and it never will. Find out what people will quietly submit to, and you will have found the exact measure of injustice and wrong that will be imposed upon them. And these will continue till they are resisted with either words or blows or with both. The limits of tyrants are prescribed by the endurance of those they oppress. Unquote. This is not easy to hear. But we're sensing it now, aren't we? Frederick Douglass goes on talking about those people who died or who killed to ensure their freedom from slavery in the United States. Those people who chose to die rather than be enslaved. Those people who, like Douglass, saw violence as the only resort to an evil system. I am not so sure that I disagree with him on that point. Douglass was speaking in New York, celebrating the emancipation of slaves in the British West Indies 23 years prior. But in the United States, on August 3rd, 1857, slavery was still legal. People were still being bought, sold, hunted down, abused. Our Civil War came less than 4 years after Douglass's speech, and emancipation another 4 years later. So, was violence necessary to end the evil of slavery? Probably. Even with slavery's end, we know that equality was not guaranteed, neither legally or culturally. Here we are, over 150 years later, in a culture and a country built on a foundation of patriarchy and white supremacy. Patriarchy and white supremacy, which means I have privilege just because of who I am and what I look like. I don't have to teach my children about being extremely careful how they approach police officers. I don't have to worry about going for a run in the nighttime. I'm not perceived as either a threat or a target, right? I mean, it's all those pieces of others' lives which I don't have to think about, which is my privilege. If you can live your life without having to think about race, that's your privilege right there. So what do we do? How do we change a system which we are so enmeshed in and born from that we don't even see it? Well, we ask for help. We do some really hard work. We get uncomfortable, and we listen to disturbing and maybe unwelcome truths from people who can see that reality that we can't. I have to be open to hear uncomfortable and painful truths before I can do some really uncomfortable and painful work in my own life and in my own community. I saw a social media post recently which highlighted this truth. Plain text. Teach me about racism, they say, but do not hurt my feelings, make me upset, talk about violence, allude to my privileges, never ever contradict what I already believe in. Yes, sometimes people say they want to get better at something. They say they want to learn and grow, but only in a very comfortable and easy fashion, a way that won't challenge or upset their lives. Please teach me about racism in our culture and how I can be an anti-racist working toward equality. Oh, but don't upset my worldview. Challenge my understandings. It's an absurdity, an impossibility. If we want to change a system, if we're actually committed to learning and working about anti-racism, then we're going to have to be challenged and upset. And hopefully, yes, hopefully, lose some of our privilege. I'm speaking to myself here. I'm speaking to anyone with any sort of privilege. Does your identity give you a head start or a boost up? The fight for justice is one where you lose something. It's a fight against yourself, which is good. For growth of this kind can only come through loss, through pain, through struggle. Frederick Douglass, if there is no struggle, there is no progress. God, what a place to start. I thought we were talking about butterflies emerging from chrysalises on the first day of spring, and here I am jumping into slavery and racism. Yeah, we'll talk about Easter later, life coming from death, all things being renewed. Spring is the perfect time to talk about learning and growing and striving for a better world. The caterpillar eats a bunch of food, wraps itself up, and then boom, out emerges a butterfly. But, and this is part of the story that I think Dad didn't mention to the kid, while in the chrysalis, the caterpillar becomes a pile of goo. All right, this is from a 1912 article in Scientific American. Quote, first, the caterpillar digests itself, releasing enzymes to dissolve all of its tissues. If you were to cut open a cocoon or a chrysalis at just the right time, caterpillar soup would ooze out. Getting a look at this metamorphosis as it happens is difficult. Disturbing a caterpillar inside its cocoon or chrysalis risks botching the transformation. This is the correlation, the place where our faith, butterflies, and racism all intersect. We are committed to a just world, right? We want to get to a place where we are instruments of peace, of equality, of anti-racism. This is the work of renewing faith. We want to renew our faith to be focused on making the world a better place. We want to be renewed by our faith, ever committed to our highest ideals, right? I mean, that's a big reason people come to religious institutions. I want to be a better person. I want to help the world be a better place. Here's the mission of the church that Reverend Reber was speaking in. The mission of the Unitarian Universalist Church of Delaware County is to ignite personal growth. Got some news for you. Igniting something means setting it on fire. Oh, sure, I want to get excited about personal growth. I want to be fired up about becoming a better person. The analogy works great. Igniting personal growth, getting fired up. There's a spark of inspiration, a flame of excitement. Fire is exciting, fire is energetic, and fire is devastating. Fire is painful. Fire gets rid of the old and makes way for the new. If we ignite our personal growth, we are getting to that place of letting go of our old ways of thinking and preparing for new ways of thinking, for a renewal of faith. That's the intersection, the point at which the struggle is necessary for progress. the point at which the caterpillar turns to goo in its way towards transformation, the point at which we say yes to a renewal of faith, which necessitates letting go of comfortable ways of being and embracing the uncomfortable realities. Sometimes we want that growth without the growing pains. We want the crops without plowing up the ground, the rain without the thunder and lightning, the ocean without the awful roar of its many waters. Oh, but we are comfortable. Our religion tells us that we're valuable. We have worth and dignity. Yes, and we have value and dignity and worth, and that doesn't mean our job is done. We also believe in justice, equity, compassion, peace, liberty, justice, aspirations which come at a cost, progress which comes with a struggle. Now I'm talking about a renewal of faith, both in community and personal. We renew our beliefs all the time. We come to new understandings and new comprehensions with respect to the world and respect to our place in it. While at the same time, our faith compels us to renew our actions, renew our commitments. So what does that look like? Renewal looks like engaging in difficult conversations. Renewal looks like going to therapy, or doing the hard work of self-discovery and healing. Renewal looks like struggle, like discomfort, like asking for help and being open to criticism. Renewal means praying and hoping for the crops and the plowing, being ready for the rain and the lightning. It's being ready to turn into a pool of goo before transforming into something different. Now, I go to therapy, writes Reverend Weber, not because I want a pat on the back and tell me I'm doing a great job. I go to therapy because I have some stuff I want to work through. I want progress, so I get beneficial struggle. Now, I'm reminded of a story I read many years ago. It's called Maniac McGee. Title character, his name is Maniac, gets really good at untying knots. Eventually, the neighborhood children come around when their shoelaces are stuck tight and whether their yo-yo strings are in a tangle, and Maniac is able to untangle them all. So he tackles larger and larger knots. At a pivotal moment in the story, Maniac tackles an enormous knot of almost mythical proportions. Now, he succeeds in untangling the knot, spoiler alert, but his success is not what has stuck with me over the years. What stuck with me was that at the middle of his struggle, the knot is larger. As he's picking, as he's searching, working, tugging here or there, the knot itself is physically larger. His problem is bigger than when he started. Anyone who's ever tried to untie stuck shoelaces knows the physical truth here. When you want to undo a knot, there's a moment just before success, when the problem has grown, a moment when the conundrum you started with is larger, and that's the moment we're looking for. The moment when the knot is of Herculean proportions, when there are strings going this way and that way, our little ball is now larger than we can see at one glance. That's the moment when we know we're on the right path. Only when Maniac has the knot expanded and enlarged, that's the only time he can start to see how to untangle it. Only when the caterpillar is torn apart can the butterfly start to grow. Only when I start to pick through my own prejudices and delve into my privilege can I see what connects where and how to transform. Only when we sit with a therapist and untangle our distress or anxiety can we start to imagine a different path forward. Only when our community gets into the thick knots of cultural oppression and internalized racism can we conceive of untangling them. Now, if you're an engineering type, this is the exploded view of something. The drawing or diagram which shows all the internal pieces of a machine or a piece of equipment, an engine is exploded into a schematic that shows all the pistons, the spark plugs, the shafts, the tubes. The drawing is nice and neat, and it can help us diagnose problems and see areas of possible improvement. Actually, taking a tool and opening it up takes lots of time and energy and possibly struggle to know what came from where, what can be altered or fixed. That's the struggle we must do for our progress. That's the work we need to do for our faith renewal. The struggle to open up our knots, to see ourselves in exploded view, and then to get in there and spend some time in areas of pain, weakness, or fault. Jeez, what a downer, right? Isn't religion supposed to comfort as well as challenge? All I'm hearing is challenge, 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 struggle, struggle, struggle. Yes, and the challenge is clear. The comfort comes from the same place, and it's twofold. One is that we can all grow, we can all progress, and we can all renew. And second is that when you are most in the struggle, you're probably on the right path. If you're feeling like a pile of goo, if your knot is so large that you can't see the ends, if you're in the struggle but don't yet see the progress, good for you. That's where the transformation happens. You are in the perfect place for renewal and growth. If not already, talk to others. Reach out to professionals. Seek community. We all have opportunities for renewal. It might be hard, but we can do it with support and love guiding us. Step into the struggle, the unknown, the scary. Become the goo. You can do it. You can make progress if you are open to the struggle. Amen and amen, Reverend Andrew Weber.
That was a barn burner. I love it. So this is my daughter, Emily. So hello, Emily.
Hi.
We're going to share with you one of our favorite songs that kind of drives home this idea that we need to kind of get moving and some of the tackle some of the struggle. It's by one of our favorite groups called the Indigo Girls, and it's called A Hammer and a Nail. And we were going to introduce the, since we haven't done much singing today, you guys get to try the chorus out. I'll teach it to you, and then we'll see how it goes. Chorus goes like this.
Gotta get out of bed, get the hammer and a nail, learn how to use my hands. Not just my head, I think myself in a jail. Now I know a refuge never grows from a chin and a hand in a thoughtful pose. Gotta tend the earth if you wanna roll. Gotta get out of bed, get a hammer and a nail, learn how to use my hands. Not just my head, I think myself in a jail. Now I know a refuge never grows from a chin in a hand and a thoughtful pose. Gotta tend the earth if you wanna roll.
Alright, we'll sing a little bit now.
Clearing webs from a hovel, a blistered hand on the handle of a shovel. I've been digging too deep, I always do. I see my face on a surface, I look a lot like Narcissus. A dark abyss of an emptiness, standing on the edge of a drowning blue. Look beyond my ears for the green, and even my sweat smells clean. Glare off the white hurts my eyes.
Okay, here we go.
Gotta get out of bed, get a hammer and a nail, learn how to use my hands. Not just my head, I think myself in a jail. Now I know a ref. never grows from a chin in a hand in a thoughtful pose. Gotta tend the earth if you wanna rose. I had a lot of good intentions. Sit around for 50 years and then collect a pension. Started seeing the road to hell and just where it starts. But
my life is more than a vision. This weirdest part is acting after making a decision. Started seeing the whole as the sum of its parts. I look behind my ears for the green, and even my sweat smells clean. Glare off the white hurts my eyes. I gotta get out of bed, get a hammer and a nail, learn how to use my hands. Not just my head, I think myself in a jail. Now I know a refuge never grows from a chin and a hand in a thoughtful pose. Gotta tend the earth if you wanna rose.
My life is part of the global line. I found myself becoming more immobile when I think one person in the world can't do anything. A distant nation, my community, and a street person, my responsibility. If I have a care in the world, I have a gift to bring. I look behind my ears for the green, and even my sweat smells clean. Glare off the white hurts my eyes. Gotta get out of bed, get a hammer and a nail, learn how to use my hands. Not just my head, I think myself in a jail. Now I know a refuge never grows from a chin in a hand in a thoughtful pose. Gotta tend the earth if you wanna roll.
I'd like to invite Carl to please come forward to extinguish our chalice. The words are by Alex L. There will be moments when you bloom fully and then wilt, only to bloom again. If we can learn anything from flowers, it is that resilience is born even when we feel like we are dying. Thank you. And go in peace.